condemned. But those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because they are demons. We live on the brink every day. We stand on the threshold between this world and the next one. We live and move between the ordinary and divine, between the mundane and the mystery. Too often, we forget to look up and see the angels in all in bloom. We forget that the love we give and live is a sign of eternity, God with us right now. We forget that Christ is coming.
Thank you. pausing before the event of the next few days to thank you for the amazing gift and blessing of your son. Help us this day to know you in the words spoken, in the silence experienced, and in the music enjoyed. Help us to place aside, if only for a moment, the preparations and decorations, and let us remember why you came. Help us to see your light in the darkness. Help us to hear your call to return to faithful living. Help us to know your blessing and love poured out for all. Help us all to know life in all its fullness. And so, in silence, in a moment of silent reflection, for this moment, we are still resting in your grace and we are most grateful. Come to my heart, Lord Jesus. Thou didst leave thy throne and thy kingly crown when thou camest to earth for me. But in Bethlehem's home, there was found no room for thy holy nativity. O come to my heart, Lord Jesus, there is room in my heart for thee. Loving Lord of all, as we wait for the birth of the Christ child, may our hearts and souls rise and be blessed by your presence. During this time together, guide us to where you would have us to be, dear God, and show us how you want us to live. O Lord, you are our maker, and we confess that we are not ready to meet you, Mary said. How can this be? And open our heart to your mystery and grace. But we say, we must see it to believe it, trusting only in what we can prove and reason with. Mary said, here am I, the servant of the Lord, and gave her life over to bury your son. Even though she knew it could mean the end of her life as she knew it, but we say, sorry, can't today. We've got too much work to do. Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and understood herself profoundly as a child and in the image of God. But we say, we are just one person, and all lives don't matter in the big picture. We confess, Lord, that we have not opened our hearts to let your spirit within us. And so, Lord, we ask that you descend upon us today, just as you did with Mary, and help us to know ourselves as agents of your work in this world. Forgive us and give us strength, O Lord. We study the trends of our times and ignore the signs of your reign. We trust in things that pass away and forget your eternal promise. Forgive us, please, O God of grace. It is getting harder and harder to focus on the true meaning of Christmas and your love in the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. We are caught up in all the gifts, the festivities, and the glitter and the glamour. Lord, we have to admit that we really do enjoy all the holiday opportunities. But as we get closer to the big family celebrations and the actual celebration of Christmas, we allow ourselves to be continually drawn to the demands of others, leaving little or no time for ourselves, our families, and especially for you. We ask for your forgiveness, O God. Lord, you already know every one of our reasons and excuses for what is happening. Help us to make some changes in our lives and our focus, so that this time of celebration may have the deepest sense of joy and purpose. Not just be the rush and bits of yet another holiday season that disappears so quickly. Keep us focused on eternal, yes, response to your call to us, to live our lives as those who would joyfully serve you. Heal and comfort us, Lord. We confess our willingness to be loved, but also our reluctance to love. We confess our readiness to accept your forgiving love, but also our refusal to forgive. We confess our eagerness to grasp your offer to redeem in love, but also our resistance to follow you without question. In this time of Advent, Lord, please forgive our failure to respond as we should. We pray that you come to us anew, and by your grace, Lord, assist us to receive with joy as the shepherds did, with gratitude as Simeon did, with obedience as Mary did, and with love as you have loved us. We ask all these things in no other name, but in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Father, Savior, let Mary open ourselves to the deity. You are with us, you are with us. Show us your presence and answer to our prayers today, which we make in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High, and our Lord. We share the fears of young couples who wait for the birth of their child in strange places without the support of their family. Lord, may all those who are pregnant and afraid to perform the life within them and draw strength from the angel giver of God. Do not stay. Watching and waiting for the coming of Christ, we pray for the promise of a new creation because our hope is in you. With expectation, we pray for the church. O God, who faithfully working to proclaim the word of God to every part of the world and provide pastoral care for the people in different faith. Let your reign of love shape us as a matter, as a master potter skillfully forms its way, that we may reveal your beauty to the world with expectation, with the world. Draw near to those who wait for you, God. Bring into their circumstances with blessings. Heal the all that awaits your restoration. With expectation, we pray for this community, Father God. Transform these communities in which we live, dear God, and inspire all those who feel futility of violence and seek lasting peace. Lord, we especially remember those people in areas of conflict, Lord. We pray for those who are troubled, may allow you to find them in knowing you, and their suffering will be eased. With expectation, we pray for loved ones, dear God. Comfort all who suffer and are in despair, those who are sick and those who care for them. May they experience your unending compassion of God. Assure us to serve you faithfully. Lord, we pray that our government leaders will be responsive to the needs of their people, especially families with young children. Lord, we pray that the poor, the kind, the lonely, and the neglected will experience God's love during this joyful season through the kindness of others, and that all those who are busy making preparation to celebrate Christmas will take time to reflect on God's love for them. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are affected by natural disaster and love of the world. Lord, we pray for those who have died. Lord, please embrace them with your love as they share in your Christmas joy and love, that they may come into eternal glory in your kingdom and truly rest in peace. Lord, we pray for those of us who gather here today, that in these final days before Christmas, that we may enter into a time of holy preparation to receive what you in our hearts and minds. Almighty God, prepare our hearts with your grace, that like Mary, you may be a worthy dwelling place for your Son. We ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Oh, in the vision. Our souls rejoice in the presence of God. Within us, minds by the power of the Holy Spirit, and as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, that by your word and spirit we may see your light. May your light pour over the pages to be read, that it will dance with newness in your heart and mind, and in your light we may find wisdom, and in your wisdom discover your peace. Amen.
Now when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live on? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd the people of Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of Judah? Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture, from following the sheep to be prince over my people of Israel, and I have been with you wherever you went, and you have cut off all your enemies from before you, and I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for people of Israel, for my people of Israel, and will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more, and evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel, and I gave you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me, and your throne shall be established forever." There ends the scripture.
Heavenly scripture reading. And my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on, all great generations will come and rest. For the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the blood in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the poor from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. Here in the scripture.
Glory to you, O God. This is the word of the Lord. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said,
"Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you."
But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her,
"Do not be afraid, Mary. For you have found favor with God, and now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob ever, and his kingdom there will be no end."
Mary said to the angel,
"How can this be, since I am a virgin?"
The angel said to her,
"The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her, who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God."
Then Mary said,
"Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word."
Then the angel departed from her. This is the gospel of Christ.
What you mean? Don't put a plate and decorate it and eat the pasta on a happy enter?
Yes, ma'am, but then it will be beautiful.
There's so much more to Christmas than the little sister. You have a Bible? You know what a Bible is, right?
Of course I do.
Okay, good. Turn to Luke chapter 1 and Colossians verse 26. Let's take a reading about verse 13.
All right.
Cheese.
You see, this is your good problem. I just asked you to read a few verses, not the whole chapter. Where you guys going to? This book has so much information that is so helpful for each and every aspect of our lives. But I bet if I asked you to go on Facebook and look for a specific post, you want to be scrolling telephone.
Okay, let me read. I just hope I don't find the ones like pouring for this to be over. And them kind of words, cause them will be no sense.
You know, the check here is anyway not only you to read the Bible or even understand all of these occasions. I mean, sometimes I wonder, I really wonder, how can we reach others? Because we have to understand that people learn in different ways.
Kelly, you might be onto something there. Because no matter who you talk to most youths today, they have the same crap. Church boring. Bible study boring. Everything boring. But we have fun at youths. And we learn. And then we go to church on 12 Sunday, especially when Reverend Selena is preaching. She always makes sure that if we don't understand the message, she says, you know her favorite line, right?
Break it down. And it's really important to break it down. Because as much as we read or we listen to messages, are we really understanding? How can we break things down in a way that appeals to everybody? Because everybody doesn't know the same.
Definitely. So when Shakia doesn't read those verses, how are we going to break this Christmas story down for her? And not just to begin away. I want to get to her in a way that she will understand. We have to make this interesting for her.
You know, I don't expect a little words that someone by me in trying to reach young people too. So we have to do things differently in a creative way in order to reach everybody.
I got it, Kelly. Music. This girl always listening to music. Let's take it from that angle, because Christmas involves a lot of singing and rejoicing. Let's see if she finished reading a few verses. I bet you she already listened to music. Hold on, let me check. Shakia, you don't read the verses?
Yeah, I read them, but I know it's quite a big deal. It's about a woman having a baby in a manger as a gift for Christmas. I ain't sticking my heaven decorations and sticking my brother there.
Kelly, before we continue, can you pray first, please? Because we need every own son of God to be in this world.
You're right. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for calling up us young people to your service today. And in particular, this moment, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to teach your word and share the news with others. Lord, we may be a bit overwhelmed at the thought of teaching the gospel, because sometimes we feel so unworthy to share such news of your son. Lord, we ask that you will send a ray of your light to penetrate the darkness of our understanding and give us the confidence to complete this task. And now, may the words of our mouths and meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, all heaven. Amen.
Okay, so after that, Mary prayed.
God, why would you choose me for such an opportunity? But you know, like he said, God chose Mary. And I knew God to trust. So right there alone, the word of God tells us that he can use anybody to do his work here below. You don't have to be rich and you don't have to have a degree. God can use you.
Look at the scripture you read. Look at verse 28. Right there it tells you that God chose her. She was faithful. Mary was set apart from every other woman of God. Mary had known that. Mary had a relationship with this God that is intimate. Okay? This wasn't a regular singular relationship. You know how the people in the States stop playing church? Mary wasn't playing church.
Yes, Tanisha. But if you look at verse 38, see what Mary said. Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be according to your word. She had to know the word of God and how to respond when God calls. If she knew the word, that means she also knew Isaiah 7, verse 14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman is with child and shall bear a son. And shall name him Emmanuel. I read this verse cross for mine when the angel was there speaking to her.
So what I see is a prophet
now. Okay, really shall be. Nobody's here. Romans 3, verse 23 reminds us all that we have ours in hand. Short of God's glory. None of us are perfect. All of them, including you. Okay? We have fallen short. But God still chose her as a vessel to bring forth baby Jesus. So again, we see that God can use anyone, no matter what situation, to do a mighty thing. In this case, something that was going to change the world, and her world was about to be changed and upside down. There I am, she said. I mean, Mary was grim. Mary didn't think about it. She just said, here I am. Use me.
Well, y'all know me personally, being up here and sharing this message, that would not be me maybe a year or so ago. You know, my voice used to be normal, and then out of the blue, it just started changing. Like, what was going on? And I know at times now, it may be difficult to understand, but with the encouragement of God's word and the right people, I take my example from Mary. God can use anyone, much like how he used Mary, and how he is using my voice now to share this message. And if you hit me in the back, I'll bring the mic a little closer. I ain't ever be quiet on something. I'll use this very voice to praise God, because right here is a testimony of his good word. I asked God to give me my voice back, but you see, I didn't understand then that my voice is more than what I say. It's also what I do.
Yeah.
The devil likes when we stay silent in our struggles and in our troubles.
Yeah.
He loves them. But Psalm 34 talks to us about deliverance from these very struggles. It's a psalm of praise and deliverance. And today, I can boldly proclaim, I will bless the Lord at our time.
Yeah.
And praise shall continually be in my mouth, because I sought him and he answered me and delivered me from all of my fears. My prayer is for us young people to see that the Lord is good, because happy those who take refuge in
you. I had some rough waters when in my lifetime, and I wish I knew the one like Mary did in my 4 years. I wish I had the courage back then like she did to see God. Here I am, losing. But you know, it is important that we believe the word. It is the reason why God is a strength. The strength that comes when we read his word and apply it, no matter. When the angel spoke to Mary later down in verses 46 and 47, she responded with praising God, saying, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in my Savior." Mary knew all about what the angel was going to say to her, but she took it, and she took it, and she owned it. In those days, the world was seen as dead. And you know what? When baby Jesus was born, darkness was great, because that light, the world can put it out.
So, he could have just said, let there be more light, they go here and do the first time around.
Yes, he did it before, and so he wanted to change things up. This time, he chose to send another light. This time, it wasn't just a light to physically light the world. It was a light that was born in the hearts, souls, and minds of everyone. It was a light that would blind the hurt, the pain, and all the hopelessness that we feel today. It was a light to bring joy to all the darkness. It was a light of restoration and peace. And this light could have only shown in this way. He knows we have a hard time believing in things we cannot see. So he chose to send a human form of himself to redeem all that sin had taken.
It's just like we were talking about earlier. It's like we hear this Christmas story all the time, but in the same way, all the time. They don't take it or break it down or anything. So the message gets lost. So God created the world and put everything in. Yet we still sin. He flooded the world to get rid of all the sin and hoping that people would see the need for him in all the darkness. There are many examples in the Bible where God gave us, you know, a chance to catch ourselves. But did we take the hint? Not at all. So he tried again in another way, in a big way this time, using the Virgin Mary. The old people would say, the least of the apostles, he chose something. He could get the people's attention. Something happened, and he sent his son into the world for all of us, so that all of us can be saved from this inherited life of sin.
Boy, it really matters how you see something, you know, because now that I break it down like this, I totally agree. No way get a hate for all the day. So now I see. Well, they don't say the things that they say. Like, we pray up here, praying Steve and for money. We pray because it's an honor for us to bless God with our music.
Yeah.
Because God gave us a talent. Yeah. Oh, when they say we're doing something for God, it has to be done at our best. He gave us his best, he gave us his son. I really got something taken to me. The real gift is the son and the reason why he came. If it wasn't for Christ, there would be no Christmas. And we out there having Christmas without Christ in it, that's messed up. I feel bad. I can't carry on about Baba Burger decoration when all I need to carry is him in my hat and praise him and tell others about him. It looks like that's what the journey is.
Now you definitely it. We young people need to be as brave as Mary and not go back from the praises. How many of us can boldly say, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior." I know this new group in particular. We love music. We love to listen, and we love to play it.
You don't know, all I think is a good rhythm and a gun.
I have to agree. incorrect people, because music is music. It's the song that is the song that the notes make. The lyrics make the song. So negative lyrics, where do you want to put on negative thing in your life? And it's the lyrics that make the music. That you have to be very conscious of the lyrics that you're listening to. Some people are going to judge or praise you, and when they're gone, outside the room, they're doing your ears, you want to know where they're coming from.
Yeah. It was obviously important to look to make mention about this praising, especially around this Christmas time. Mary's song in Luke 1:46-55, which they named the Magnificat, says that Christ came to love the forgotten. And Zechariah's song found in Luke 1:70-69 says that Christ came to save us. And the angel's song found in Luke 2:13-14 says that Christ came to give up us peace. And don't forget Simeon's song found in Luke 2:29-32 says we have to keep Christmas with us and share it. This is why we are trying to keep the traditional caroling songs like Oh Come All Ye Faithful and Oh Little Town of Bethlehem, which remind us that Christ came to love the forgotten people. And songs like Oh Come Emmanuel tells us that Christ came to save us. And the songs I Pour the Bells on Christmas Day and Oh Holy Night remind us that Christ came to give us peace. All these songs remind us that we are to keep Christmas with us and share it with everyone else.
Don't know what extra people about the Christmas story. I never understand when one of them wants to be out all night till morning caroling, singing the same Christmas songs year after year to the same people. But now I understand that they're sharing all those reminders of peace and being saved, because you have to share it. I think I'll be going up for this year. And now that I really understand my song means, I hope I sing it, that I remind people of the reason for Christmas. Reminding them that there is a light in all of the darkness. And I may not know the whole Bible by not the thing. And I might be biased to music, yes, but I try to read the scriptures in a way that it's related to me. And Psalm 51 is one that I love, because it does confuse me. Because if I remember well, it says that we should praise God with trumpet song, with a tambourine and dance, with strings and pipes, and even with the low clashing cymbals. That's what the Bible says. So if this is the word of God, and this is supposed to be a guideline for us all, including the church, if we are instructed to praise Him in this way, then why would we just tone down? Oh, that's too low. Oh, don't hit the drum so hard. And why are we going to dance and be praising God if this is what He wants us to do? Is it that we can tell God that we ain't praising what He wants to be praised? He wants us to do it. He blessed Mary because He favored her for what she praised Him. Is this why the church has so many problems? Because we praise Him with
the right word. Sis, you can't be worried about what others do. God wasn't worried with the Lord. God wasn't worried about the body when He chose Mary.
That's right.
And you know, the only thing that was done, the only thing that would be done to praise Him is the last. Okay? So if God tells you to praise Him in that way, you get your praise up. You don't let nobody out your fire. If you can quench your last year, every corner you turned, it was the pumping, it was the singing. Let me tell you something. Nobody can hold that flame. That you can quench you. You know what I said? Forever fire up for praise. And I will praise God in ever what I can. If I have to shout, if I have to sing it, if I have to dance, I can't let nobody stop me.
So you said earlier that Mary was like all age. All age listen to music. And and we believe that all our music is godly. Yes, some of us get carried away with beat, but you use the things that they are attracted to in order to bring them. You can't teach somebody that ain't dead. Mm-hmm. Something has to bring us in. So if it's the music, let's use the music. Amen. And let God get blessed.
Amen.
You're right. Music is used as an escape for a lot of us young people. Even scientific research shows that the positive effects of music calms mood, releases stress and anxiety, and even lifts our spirits.
Exactly. That's the only place some of us have to talk. Take us deep and group, for example, that feeling that comes over us when we're playing that song that blessing our Lord. Especially after all the time we take to learn. If God feels any way close to how we feel, then I understand and I ain't coming out.
Amen.
Some people think because we are young, we don't understand what we feel as God, or that we don't even know God. But a lot of us do, and we just want to praise Him in our own way. We don't want to be conformed to a way that anyone else is praising God. Why my praise have to be the same as yours? My hallelujah is my hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going
to be God.
Alone. I, for one, always happy when music is pleasing to God. I can't sit still when some sweet music playing here. I have to shake.
Why? I can't even imagine Christmas without music. What that can be? Some of these carolings really touch me. And I love when we go out caroling and you could see the smiles on everybody's faces. And you know that God could be feeling what you're feeling. I mean, it's different when you're telling somebody what they can hear you enough. But when you add a little music, oh my, it just comes to me. And you might understand what you're trying to say.
Well, yeah, let's do it in a new way. Let's lead a new way. Christmas is praise. Christmas is praising God for the gift of His Son. So let's play Mary and praise God when He shakes us up. Let's play Mary and say, here I am, without worrying about anybody else.
In. Especially since God has touched me early and He has called me and said, come, let me use you, my life has never been the same. As much as some days are rough, you know what? He never leave my side, you know? He ain't like everybody. He said, man, I can be great for me. And when I'm looking for them, the camera going on. When I stand in the car, oh, look, he did. So why worrying about loving this thing? Because whenever I try to do anything without God, guess what? Is that epic thing.
You know, there are hundreds of scriptures in the Bible alone talk to us about Jesus and being the light of His world. One of my favorites, John 8:12, says that Jesus is the light of the world, and whoever follows Him will not walk in darkness, but will have I choose it over everything. Never again will I choose the darkness of my past or anything that can happen to me in this life. I choose Jesus Christ. He is the light in all of us, and we can't allow it to go dim. Especially because people and things can't compensate for that light.
So I just remember, God uses anyone to do His will, but we must be willing though. He may force us. If we don't have a strong desire to do His will, we might miss out on the purpose He has for life. As a consequence, He may allow some unfortunate situations to happen in our lives so that they will bring us to the place where we will be to desire His will. So we should be careful. God also uses people that are willing to pay the cost. Mary put her whole reputation at risk will was uncomfortable for Mary, but she passed up and she did it. Stepping out of our comfort zone helps us to grow. Also, God uses people who has faith to trust His promises. When we decide to follow the beautiful life of Jesus, we are saved by faith. We live by faith and we walk by faith.
Amen. God, amen. If we really can have this Christmas now, don't forget to share it. I hope that God continues to use us, like how He used Mary and many others in the Bible. And I hope when He calls, our answer will be, "Here I am, use me." I pray that we won't just allow the light, but we will also live and walk in the love and the light that is Jesus.
I hope you understand this Christmas story. You know what I mean, right?
Like,
you know what? Guess what? You break it down for you. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this time of fellowship and enlightenment. You so loved this world that you gave your only begotten Son. He who was rich became poor for us. The eternal Word was made flesh and became a great light shining. Only because of your word and spirit can we see the light and be drawn into the grace. Give us the grace that we may humbly and joyfully receive your Son, even as the shepherds and the wise men who love him. May we look no further for our redemption than to this child laying in the manger. May we bring glory and honor to your name in all that we do, as you conform us to the image of your Son Jesus. Lord, you know that you want to use us just as we are. So may it please you to use us to lead those who need encouragement, to those who are lost, to those who are wandering, and to those who are confused, into your way and your truth. Lord, we pray that this message has warmed even one heart, that you will enter the room and dwell where we have been true. May the spirit of Christmas, that is peace, the beauty of Christmas, that is hope, and the blessing of Christmas, that is joy, be in abundance this Christmas and every Christmas to come. You are the light of the world, and you will let your light shine so that people may see your good works and give you glory. This we pray in your name, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Let's talk about music and me.
also a joy to have in our midst Sister Harriet Cameron, who was away with her mom, and she's in the church field. Harriet is in church, actually. So we give our thanks for our being back home. Let us continue to remember in our prayers the sick and shut-in members in this congregation and the wider community. Pray also for those who have lost loved ones. Pay them a visit. Give a phone call, which will be greatly appreciated. Sister Eunice Cameron is now at home recuperating, and one of the things that she's saying is that everyone is welcome to come by. At this time, I'll call on Sister Shian Ben.
Everybody who here this morning has 7 o'clock, such a beautiful service.
Sunday service will be conducted by Reverend Simon. Words of gratitude are extended to everyone who made this service such an outstanding success. We also thank, and I don't really want to get to him in calling, but I have to say, Brother Edward Parson, Caleb Boston, and Caleb. Christmas.
17, I was here.
Downstairs.
Christmas Sunday. And I couldn't find my sermon. And I preached from my heart.
Amen.
And I said to Zion that I preach about this kingdom, the kingdom of Zion through David. And I said the congregation that was downstairs, that y'all can mourn until that big chapel that was mourning upstairs. And if you don't know that God is real, I am saying to you, Zion, awake, awake. Christ is coming soon.
Amen.
Let us know that in the midst of the struggle, you want to hear whether good and faithful to us. Zion was even 20 downstairs. There was even a young me. We got testimonies, but we have a praise that is going to the world. And God. And this morning I didn't have to bring a sermon, but I bring a testimony and a blessing like the young people did. So then to one shall lead them. Praise the Lord. My soul doth magnify the Lord.
Amen.
And my spirit praise his name. Even death could not hold me. Even in the grave, he lives. Is there anyone in the congregation this morning that does, that feels forgotten? Is there anyone in the congregation this morning who feels hopeless? Is there anyone in the congregation that believes that they cannot be used? Please come socially distant in the aisle and the front of the altar and talk to me about this morning. If you feel that you don't have purpose, if you feel that there's nothing in you that God can use, you come to the altar. Here I am. Lord, use me.
gracious God and ever-living Father. We thank you for the abundant grace that you have sent to us, in us, for us, and wrapped it up in swaddling cloth and laid it in a feeding ground so that we can know that you are the light of the world. Feed us, Lord. Feed us till we want no more. Feed us until we come home to you in the everlasting promise. Amen. And let us say the benediction to one another, watching our brothers and sisters. And now, may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, love, joy, and serve the Lord.